Hello everyone, I'm Larry Diamond. I think I've gotten to know most of you by now through our Democracy MOOC, which is happy to host this session here from the United States State Department today with Dr. Tomicah Tillemann. Tomicah is the Senior Advisor to the Secretary of State for Civil Society and Emerging Democracies. Interesting that there is someone in that building with that important title. He has worked in this area for many years. He was on the staff of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, was a speechwriter to Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, and several years ago became her senior advisor, now Secretary John Kerry's senior advisor for civil society and emerging democracies. Tomicah Tillemann has a PhD from the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies and an undergraduate degree from Yale. Tomicah, welcome.
Thank you.
A number of our students in the MOOC on democratic development, I know, who are interested in hearing you, since you are the senior advisor on civil society and have been thinking about it for a number of years now. Let's start with the most general question. How would you define or conceptualize civil society?
That's a great question, and certainly there are many different answers. But as we look at civil society, we think of our nations as being supported by three legs of a stool. You have, in the first hand, government, where political activity takes place. Then you have the private sector, where we work for economic gain. And then finally, you have civil society, where we come together in civic organizations, in religious congregations, as professors in academia occasionally, as journalists, and we work together through peaceful means to make our nations better. And that really is the defining constant of civil society, regardless of where you go in the world. You find citizens who are committed to building a better future for their country, who decide to work together either within their nation or across national boundaries to accomplish that goal.
So I think that's great. And as I emphasize in the course, it's extremely important that these efforts involve citizens coming together independently of the state, without state or political party direction, and kind of on a horizontal basis where everyone is equal to undertake this collective work. We've talked in the course about how this kind of growth of independent initiatives, organizations, movements in civil society can either help bring democracy into being by mobilizing against authoritarian rule, or can help in a variety of ways to reform and deepen democracy. But several of the students in this class live in non-democratic societies and wonder how this can be done, how civil society can emerge and do this work in countries where the enabling environment is not very facilitating. I'd like to read you the question of Alex Ivanov from Russia, who asks, some commentators claim that civil society doesn't exist in a country, for example, Russia. Is there a litmus test or are there any signs that can prove or disprove the existence of civil society in a certain country? So how would you recognize civil society in a country like Russia?
That's a very interesting question. And I think, Alex, if you look more broadly around the world, we're living through an extraordinary moment. We're witnessing a fundamental renegotiation of many of the relationships between citizens and governments. And as a result of advances in technology and some shifts in culture, for the most part, it's never been easier or cheaper to bring people together around common ideas and unite them in civil society. Now, there are some countries that are embracing that phenomenon and see it as a chance to foster better governance and greater accountability. But there are also some governments, frankly, that are very concerned by the prospect that groups outside of government would be able to hold them accountable. And we've seen an increasing trend in many countries that are passing laws designed to restrict civic space and limit the ability of civil society to carry out its work. Along with that, we've seen a number of fledgling efforts to try and create metrics that can gauge the health of the ecosystem for civil society. Certainly in Russia, we see some remarkable civil society organizations. You think about groups like Memorial, which have a long, proud history of championing human rights. And then in some other areas, more recently, there have been some fascinating civic efforts around issues that face motorists, for example. So there are a wide range of different civil society organizations, even in Russia. But the reality is that civil society organizations in Russia continue to face severe challenges, and that while civil society can exist even in spite of those challenges, we think all countries and all governments stand to do better if they create the space for civic organizations and civil society to thrive and help move their country forward.
So is it fair to say that we can look for civil society outside the realm of formal organizations with formal names? In a lot of countries, not only Russia but China, we see citizens coming together to protest outrages of various kinds or abuses of rights, maybe individual rights, maybe environmental rights. We may see people protesting because they've been pushed off their land or because a chemical plant is going to be built somewhere in a fashion that has not prepared for the potential environmental damage. So if people come together, maybe they haven't known one another previously, but they're using what I'd call liberation technology to communicate and organize, and then they're there in the streets saying, hey, what about us? Is that civil society?
Absolutely. And I think it's important to recognize that while in many countries civil society exists primarily or predominantly in the form of civil society organizations, in many other cases, civil society does take a much looser and more informal structure. And that form of civil society is every bit as legitimate and in many instances even more important. And we know that it is through engagement, often within those formal informal structures, that we're able to bring people together, generate social capital, and build trust in our societies, and ultimately ensure stronger institutions and greater accountability. So that form of civil society expression and association is, I think, absolutely essential in any nation, but especially in those where there is a more restrictive environment.
You mentioned social capital.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very important word and a very important concept for this course. So explain what you mean by that.
Well, social capital is an idea that has very deep roots within social science, but it's essentially refers to the connections that bind people together and the trust within communities and among individuals. And the interesting thing as it relates to civil society is we know now from a generation of social science that we do something in civil society far more effectively than we're able to do it in either government or the private sector. And that is to generate trust, to generate social capital. And so we see a very compelling interest for strengthening civil society that frankly transcends any specific issue or any specific point on anyone's agenda and really goes to the core of what it means to be a successful nation. Civil society is how we replenish that reservoir of trust that irrigates everything we do within our countries, whether it's within government or within the private sector or the civic sector. And so we see a vibrant civil society as absolutely essential to a nation's ability to move forward and realize its potential.
So we can think of social capital as a kind of parallel to financial capital. It's there as a resource that can be drawn on if you have the trust and if you have what Putnam called these horizontal ties of trust and reciprocity and so on. But then we get to Marilyn Ojeda's question. Marilyn is from Mexico, and she asks, how do you build trust among people in a society where corruption is just pervasive? I guess it's kind of a chicken and egg problem. Do you build the trust first and then everything follows from it, or do you work on the manifestations of distrust, like the pervasive corruption, and then as a result of that work, see willy-nilly the accumulation of more social trust?
Well, I think it's a very important question and one that we face in too many countries around the world. One of the constants that we find is that in almost every instance when meaningful change does occur in a nation, and when serious reform takes hold, that effort begins in civil society. And initially, you have individuals coming together outside of government to try and build a circle of trust among those who are passionate about addressing these challenges. And so my suggestion to Marilyn and anyone in a similar situation would be to find those who share your concerns, find those who are interested in fostering accountability and transparency and meaningful democracy, and work together among that group of people to bring about the change that you seek to see in your country.
Or as Gandhi said, be the change you seek to see.
Exactly.
And I completely agree with you, Tomicah. My experience is when you've got a situation of very extensive corruption, and Mexico is very, very far from the worst, we both know, if citizens organize from the grassroots and come together as equals to, first of all, try and monitor and expose what's happening, and then lobby for reforms to try and change the laws, they can improve the situation. But if they're just going to wait for the state to do it for them, that doesn't seem like a very promising approach, because why would the state have an initiative to do that?
Well, Mexico is actually a fascinating example in this regard, and that even just a few decades ago, people commonly referred to Mexico as the perfect dictatorship. And it certainly is not that today. As you imply, the country has come a tremendous distance, notwithstanding the challenges that it still faces. And much of the progress that has occurred within Mexican society, again, originated within civil society. And so in many respects, I think it's a fascinating case study in how these principles can play out in practice. Mexico today is playing a leading role in the Open Government Partnership, which is an initiative that brings together over 60 countries around the world who are interested in fostering greater accountability and transparency and really remaking the relationship with their citizens. And they're also a member of the Governing Council of the Community of Democracies. So we've seen some very important progress in Mexico. And I think there are many other countries where that same trend of civil society leading efforts for reform is taking hold.
So I think it was Mario Vargas Llosa, the great Peruvian novelist, who gave that appellation to Mexico as the perfect dictatorship, because there was a time during the 60s, 70s, 80s, and early 90s when there was this multi-party competition, but you knew the PRI was going to win. We now have a name for that that we didn't analytically before: competitive authoritarianism, or at least electoral authoritarianism. We have a question from someone who hails from another competitive authoritarian regime, Venezuela, Graciela Zadrozny. And she comes at this from a different angle. Her concern is, here is a regime, she believes, many observers believe, who've been systematically promoting violence and who operate in a climate of impunity for their acts in a way that disorganizes civil society. If there are high rates of criminal violence and maybe political targeting of oppositionists, it creates a context that's not very facilitating for civil society. So again, her question is, how can civil society function in a situation like that?
Well, it's certainly not easy. And it's one of the reasons why we are working very hard with many partners around the world to try and create a better environment for civil society within countries. Even in a very challenging situation like what confronts civil society activists and leaders in Venezuela, I think it's crucial for them to recognize that they're in very good company. Virtually every major social advance that's occurred in the United States and any nation throughout our history has faced serious opposition and serious challenges. Even if we look at our own nation, beginning with our push for independence or the abolition of slavery or the civil rights movement, these were intense struggles that took many years and a great deal of bravery to overcome. And I have great confidence that with courage and persistence, the forces that seek for democracy and greater accountability in several countries in Latin America will eventually see success. But these are long-term challenges, and it requires, as I indicated, a great deal of bravery in order to operate as a civil society activist in that environment. It's frankly very easy to sit here in Washington and discuss these challenges in a more academic setting. It's much harder and much more dangerous to do so on the ground. So we recognize those challenges and have tremendous admiration and respect for the individuals who are willing to make the sacrifices required to seek for democracy in those circumstances.
Thank you for saying that, Tomicah, because I think the people who are watching this in countries like Russia, China, Venezuela, Iran, if they can find a way to connect to this, will be very grateful for the acknowledgement of the risks they take and the sacrifices they've made to struggle for an open society. We've learned a lot about what makes for transitions to democracy from various types of authoritarian regimes. And one of the things I think we've learned in this class, but more broadly, is the very important role that greater space for civil society and greater organization in civil society, as well as the mastery by civil society activists of the tools of mobilization, both in terms of organizing and in some of the new social media and technological tools, the enormous contributions they make. However, we as scholars and we maybe as advocates organizers for democracy, and now I say we because I know that includes some of the students in this class, are not the only ones who have internalized these lessons. Autocrats are studying these lessons as well. And as a result, we see an authoritarian pushback that's been underway for a number of years to criminalize civil society activity and to criminalize and stigmatize as disloyal to the country the receipt of international assistance for the work of civic education, democratic reform, civic advocacy on behalf of people in the country and their protests and concerns, and basically a very clever effort to use, quote, the law to shrink the space for civil society. So what are your views about this authoritarian pushback against civil society and how people who are struggling against the pushback can be assisted?
Well, we used to speak with great enthusiasm about the exchange of best practices between governments and about the possibility that exists for nations to learn from one another and improve their accountability, improve their transparency through that exchange of ideas. Unfortunately, these days we're talking just as much about the exchange of worst practices. And what we found is that in over 40 countries in the last couple of years, there have been new laws and regulations imposed that are designed to restrict the space in which civil society can operate. And this is having a devastating effect on the ability of many organizations to work on behalf of a wide range of goals. We see this as a huge problem, and on the margins of the UN General Assembly this year, President Obama came together with a dozen presidents and leaders from 25 nations to address this challenge, because we've recognized that, unfortunately, this is increasingly part of the landscape on which we conduct diplomacy. And we see a real need for nations that do have an interest in accountability and do have an interest in democracy to work together to address this challenge. We also think that this is a real lost opportunity for the governments that are imposing these restrictions. And I'll give, if I can, just one very practical example. If you want to be a world-class athlete, you go out in search of a coach who's going to push you, help you to play a better game, and identify those areas where you need to improve. If you want to be a world-class musician, you're going to find a music teacher who similarly can help you excel and point out the areas where you need to practice a little more or improve your technique. And that's certainly true for governments as well. We all, in every aspect of our lives, need individuals and organizations with some independent perspective to help us realize our full potential. And by denying themselves that opportunity, these governments are in many ways imposing a ceiling on their own development and their own ability to serve their people's needs. So this is a long-term challenge. This is something that we recognize is a problem in many nations around the world. But this administration is determined to work with other partners in the international community to address the challenge.
Unfortunately, if you want to be a world-class dictator, your first imperative is to survive in power. That trumps everything else, and that's why sooner or later their performance declines, because they shut themselves off, as you eloquently noted, from the competition of ideas and the churning of innovation and best practices. But let's come back to the assistance dimension and now the international defense and advocacy of the rights and scope of civil society. Certainly, the Obama administration and others before President Obama have been quite assertive about this and have put in place, even before the creation of the office of the senior advisor to the Secretary of State for Civil Society, a number of institutions to try and strengthen civil society, including another one we talk about in this class, the National Endowment for Democracy, with its grant-making abilities. But I think it's fair to say, if you read our online forums for the course, and I do, that there's also skepticism about the United States and its motives. Why are you, the United States, doing this? What are you really after? So this raises the question of why we're doing what we're doing. Are we pursuing other agendas? Are we just trying to dislodge governments we don't like in the name of supporting democracy and civil society? And then what is the global aspect to this, the international partnership aspect to this? So maybe we could take those questions in sequence.
Absolutely. Let me start on the foreign assistance question, because that is one where we hear a lot of concerns from many countries around the world. And I'll begin again with an example very close to home. We have a lot of foreign civil society organizations that operate within the United States. They add tremendous vitality to our civic ecosystem here. I and many other Americans have been the beneficiaries of the work that they do. They've enhanced our relationship with other countries. They've enhanced our understanding of the world. And they build the social capital that we talked about a few minutes ago across borders, which is incredibly important for diplomatic cooperation. So that's one of the reasons why we think this work is important, is because we've seen civil society and international civil society improve our social ecosystem in the United States. And we think that all nations should have the same access to those opportunities. Beyond that, however, we also see a series of other compelling needs. The United States has recognized over the course of long experience that our strongest and best partners in the world are independent, vibrant, accountable governance that tend to the needs of their people. And this has now been proven out over the course of many generations. And so absolutely, we have an interest in encouraging the development of independent, strong, democratic, accountable nations and accountable governance. And civil society is an important mechanism for advancing that goal. Beyond that, though, I think this goes to something that's very fundamental, which is, do we want our nations and our citizens to be able to interact? Again, strategic partnerships go far beyond governments, and they go to people. And we want the relationships between our peoples to be strong. Diplomacy in the 21st century isn't only about the State Department speaking with someone else's foreign ministry. It's about our citizens and our civil societies working together to address the very significant challenges that we face in the world. And that can only happen if we foster the type of cooperation which we've tried to support now in many nations around the world over the course of many years.
Great. So I want to come to the global dimension of this and the community of democracies as part of that in a moment. But let me stay on this theme and convey to you the question that Camden Luxford of Australia has asked, which is, okay, we're making grants to civil society organizations, NGOs, maybe other types of organizations, maybe media enterprises, possibly through the State Department and the Office of Democracy and Human Rights, possibly from the small grant facility that an embassy on the ground may have, and certainly through the mechanisms of the National Endowment for Democracy. Camden Luxford asks, how do we ensure that we are really wanting these grants to support the work these organizations are doing rather than to just encourage them to follow a U.S. line? How do we ensure their autonomy?
Absolutely. I think it's a great question, and it's frankly one that we have been thinking a lot about. And I think our grant-making activities are very important. They provide, in many instances, kind of the startup money, the seed funding for civil society organizations to develop and take root. But we're also looking at new mechanisms of supporting civil society, and specifically trying to shift some of our support to a more demand-driven model, in which we're not telling civil society organizations the type of issues that we're interested in, and then asking them to prepare proposals in response to that, but rather we're responding to the needs of civil society organizations. And if they need technical support in a specific area, if they need help with polling or advocacy or fundraising, that we're working to provide them with the technical tools that they need, rather than simply providing funding that will address issues that we care about, which may be very good and worthwhile issues, but still in the context of trying to preserve the autonomy of civil society and the independence of civil society could hypothetically raise some questions. So we do see a need to, frankly, evolve the model that we've relied on historically. And I think we're seeing some very intriguing and promising innovations emerge that have the potential to do that.
Let me add to this that I think the model of the National Endowment for Democracy is an interesting model because it's a publicly funded enterprise with an annual congressional appropriation of now over $100 million. But it's a non-governmental organization. It has an independent board, and they make independent grants. And this, too, primarily, both through the endowment's direct support for NGOs and through its four core institutes, is doing a lot of responding to the demands coming up from civil society organizations and independent actors in these countries. And I would invite the students in this class to go to www.ned.org and click on the grants tab of the National Endowment for Democracy and just look at the kinds of organizations that they're supporting. And I think they'll see that these are pretty authentic actors, and they're not kind of pursuing an American line. They're fighting for human rights and to control corruption and to empower women and minorities and defend minority rights and to make the economy more open and free of crony capitalism, to strengthen the rights of trade unions, since one of the four core institutes of NED is the Free Trade Union Institute in a lot of these countries. Sometimes this may work against our immediate interests. If a trade union is, you know, trying to strengthen the rights of workers and raise the minimum wage in a country, maybe some American investors won't like that. But the point is, if you create a more level playing field and a deeper and more lawful society, in the end, wouldn't you say that's going to be in the American interest?
Absolutely. And I think the work of the National Endowment for Democracy in many ways exemplifies the best of American democracy support over the course now of many years, and their ability to find, as you indicate, small, authentic actors and provide them with, if you put this in technology terms, kind of the venture capital funding they need to get off the ground and create meaningful change within their society in all of these areas. And as you indicate, it's an independent organization. We don't tell the National Endowment for Democracy what to do. I think is an example that now we see other countries and other groups of countries starting to emulate because of its great success. The European Union recently initiated the new European Endowment for Democracy, which is explicitly modeled on the net. And so I think that the framework that the National Endowment has established is one that is worthy of emulation, and it's certainly produced some extraordinary dividends around the world in the form of great civic organizations and great civil society leaders.
And even relatively new and small democracies are getting into this business of trans-border assistance and aiding democracy in their region. Certainly Poland was one of the first. There have been a lot of civil society efforts in some of the other new democracies of Central and Eastern Europe that have had public support. Taiwan some years ago created the Taiwan Foundation for Democracy. So it seems to be an idea that's spreading.
Absolutely. And I think it's important to recognize that while we engage in democracy support because it's part of who we are, it's part of the DNA of our nation, we also learn a tremendous amount in the process. And the exchange of information that occurs is a two-way exchange of information. We've seen many young democracies that have developed best practices and ideas that frankly are far beyond what we have here at home. I think about e-governance in Estonia or some of the new models that have emerged for open budgeting in a number of new democracies. And we're now trying to take the tools that they have developed and the lessons that they have learned in the course of their transitions and apply them within our own democracy. So I think there are some fascinating opportunities to shift the process of building stronger democracy from something that is the individual responsibility of each nation to something that is rather the collective responsibility of an entire community of democracies and a collective undertaking. And that's hopefully where we're headed with this work.
Well, that is a perfect segue to talk about the community of democracies and the increasingly global and cooperative nature of efforts to assist democratic development around the world. I think many people, including many students in this class, when they hear the term democracy promotion, have an image of the United States coming in a very boisterous and self-confident way and saying, we're a democracy, you should be like us, here's our constitution, you really should follow it. Or certainly in the days after the Iraq War, had an even more darker image of American tanks coming in and bringing, quote, democracy to people. But of course, that's not how we think about what democracy promotion is, since it's a very much, very deeply nonviolent and cooperative effort. And in any case, it's increasingly become a globally cooperative effort. So if you could talk about how that now manifests itself and how the community of democracies increasingly is the embodiment of that.
Well, that's a fantastic question, and we're seeing some very interesting developments. If you think in technology terms for a moment, democracy is ultimately an operating system. It's the way that governments choose to organize themselves. And in order to improve an operating system, you need a users group. And the community of democracies increasingly is providing that users group. The organization was originally founded in the year 2000 by then U.S. Secretary of State Madeleine Albright and Bronislaw Geremek, who was the foreign minister of Poland. And it now brings together a wide range of countries from every region of the world, longtime democracies, as well as countries that are in the midst of transitions around the goal of strengthening engagement with civil society and strengthening civil society, and also supporting new users, supporting countries that are just developing their own democracies and consolidating democratic gains. We've seen the community take a leading role in efforts to push back against restrictions on civil society, and a working group led by Canada has been instrumental in those global efforts. Its work was recognized by President Obama at the event on the margins of the General Assembly that I alluded to earlier. And we're also seeing some very exciting new tools, something called the LEND Network, which stands for Leaders Engaged in New Democracies, brings together key actors who have helped build democracy in their own country and helped guide their own countries through transitions. And then with the help of a technology platform that's been constructed as a collaborative effort by technology companies in many different countries, allows them to communicate in real time with voice, video, text, and translation with key leaders in countries like Tunisia and Moldova, who are in the midst of very exciting and lively democratic transitions right now. So the community is providing the platform for a great deal of important cooperation and a platform for cooperation between government and civil society, which is absolutely crucial. Civil society has a seat at the table on the community's governing council, and we see the expansion of that interface between those outside of government and those inside of government as essential to strengthening democracy worldwide.
So this isn't the only transnational initiative of democracies or countries that would like to have open and responsible government work together and really pretty much on a peer-to-peer rather than hierarchical basis to achieve that goal. Another interesting initiative is one I know you've also thought about and been engaged in, and that's the Open Government Partnership. Could you say a little about that and how that works, and how is it different than the community of democracies, and what might it represent in terms of a future model of countries working together to try and in turn improve their own internal governance?
The Open Government Partnership is a marvelous, marvelous initiative. And it was, I actually just returned from London a couple of weeks ago, where I had the opportunity to participate in a summit meeting of the Open Government Partnership. As I mentioned earlier, it brings together now over 60 countries who have signed on to make concrete commitments to improve their transparency and accountability, create a stronger dialogue with civil society, and hold themselves accountable in the form of a regular review process for the commitments that they have made. It is a structure that is relatively young, and yet it's come a great deal of distance in the few years that it's been in operation. We've seen some very exciting efforts to improve transparency and accountability. Countries like Indonesia have created new platforms for civic engagement that are allowing their citizens to point out problems that they feel require the attention of government and then receive immediate feedback and immediate responses. We've also seen a variety of new efforts in the United States, for example, to create online petition structures that allow citizens within the U.S. and internationally to come together and raise issues that they feel are of particular concern. And if they receive a designated number of signatures on that electronic petition in a period of time, then the White House will issue a response to that question, regardless of what it is. And so what we're trying to do through these efforts, again, is help develop a new relationship between citizens and government, between civil society and government, and ensure that government is more responsive, more accountable, and better equipped to deliver on the promise of democracy.
Before I leave the topic of democracy assistance, I want to come back to a question that was posed by another student in the class, Severine Diallo. And Severine basically raises another kind of uncomfortable issue about civil society and democracy assistance. you see a lot of innovation, potentially on paper. It mm-hmm. looks good. A lot of people developing new organizations and then seeking support. But we know, you know, I think you know acutely, that civil society is not immune from the ills that plague society. Civil society is part of society. And when money rushes in, particularly in a context of a new transition or mm-hmm. a new political opening or a post-conflict situation like Afghanistan, people may see opportunity more than responsibility to improve governance. So what can be done by international actors to try and be mindful of the opportunistic element of this and to try and ensure that civil society and international grants to civil society don't simply become another vehicle for corruption?
That's a great question, and it's one that we've been very concerned about and have spent a lot of time on recently. I think it's important to begin with a realization that in the past, the international community, including the United States, I think has made some mistakes in this regard. And in too many instances, as you suggest, in the course of a political transition, we see a flood of resources that allow civil society organizations to take shape. But we haven't always done the work to ensure that when a few years down the road, those resources from the international community start to diminish, that there are alternate mechanisms of domestic support that can ensure the longevity of civil society and also ensure that the right actors within civil society will receive the support they need in order to create sustainable organizations. And so what we've been trying to do in this regard is shift to a variety of new models and develop some new tools that are specifically focused on cultivating philanthropy and domestic philanthropy with the goal of providing a long-term base of support, not from the international community, but from those who know civil society in a country best, the citizens and the leaders within those countries. And I think it's important for those of your students in the United States and the United Kingdom to recognize that we have a very unusual situation in our countries. When you make a contribution to civil society organizations in the United States or a handful of other nations, you receive a tax benefit as a result of doing so. But in many countries around the world, you actually receive a tax penalty and have to pay a significant chunk of money to the government on top of whatever contribution you make to civil society. And this has had the effect in too many instances of discouraging local populations from contributing to civil society and providing the support that would help ensure the survival of good long-term organizations and frankly would allow those that are in this work for the wrong reasons to fade away. And so what we're trying to do now is work with partners in the philanthropic community to create better architecture and better ecosystems for philanthropy in countries that are undergoing political transitions and in rapidly emerging economies. And again, the long-term ambition for this effort is to ensure that civil society organizations will rely a lot less on support from the international community and that local actors and local philanthropists who know the landscape and who know who's doing the work for the right reasons will be able to provide an enduring source of funding. But it's a big challenge and one that we're working to address.
So one thing I have in mind as a reaction is that once you get the development of local philanthropy and of wealthy entrepreneurs and other constellations of resources doing this empowerment and assistance of these kinds of self-help and community building and human rights raising and accountability seeking initiatives on their own, that's when you know you have a really deep and sustainable mm-hmm. civil society. But another reaction I have is wherever the money is coming from, people have to be accountable for it.
Yeah.
And if we're seeking transparency and open budgeting and, in essence, accountability from governments, shouldn't we be seeking it from civil society organizations as well?
Absolutely. And I think part of the renegotiation in the relationship between government and civil society that I was speaking about earlier involves asking civil society organizations to up their game and ensure that they are adhering to the highest standards of professionalism, the highest standards of accountability. We are, civil society organizations are asking that of government, which is the right thing to do, but we need to ensure that civil society is doing the same and that transparency and accountability are principles that transcend these sectors. So I think that it is a big responsibility for leaders within civil society to ensure that their conduct and the activities of their organizations will build the trust that we were talking about and will generate that social capital that will ensure not only the survival and success of the work that they're doing within their individual civil society organization, but also the success of the sector as a whole. And this is really a shared obligation among all those who are working within civil society and are eager to see that portion of our nations do well.
We have at another center that I co-direct at Stanford University, the Haas Center for Public Service, we've just developed something called Principles of Ethical and Effective Public Service. And I won't go into the details of them, though you can imagine that transparency and knowing what your motivations are and being honest about them are very important ones. But it seems like civil society itself needs a kind of code of conduct or a set of principles of how to operate in an effective but also ethical and transparent way. And presumably that isn't something the international community should impose, but each local civil society should have an honest dialogue about.
I think that's a very good point. Again, as governments, we wouldn't want to be the ones to create those principles, but I do think that each individual civil society organization should recognize that it's easier to be transparent now than it's been in the past. With the benefits of technology, with the benefits of the internet, it's easier to release information on your activities, on your budget, on where resources are going. And what we've seen in many instances is that to the extent individual organizations are willing to take those steps, it becomes easier to fundraise, it becomes easier to gain traction for their efforts. And so I think it's certainly part of a package of best practices that civic organizations should seek to adopt as they expand their efforts.
Great. Well, you've mentioned technology. It's been lurking through a lot of the discussions we've been having so far. As you can imagine, this is a class that has a lot of interest in information and communication technology, not least because the class is being delivered over the internet. So let's talk about liberation technology. First of all, I know that promoting greater skill and utility in the use of social media and the internet for accountability and for the extension and empowerment of civil society has been a big concern of yours and of the efforts to strengthen civil society by the State Department and other publicly funded organizations in the United States working on these issues. So talk about what you've been doing and how you see these efforts.
Well, I think even more exciting and important than what we've been doing is some of the work that civil society organizations are doing. And I'll give you just a few quick examples that I've encountered in the course of my travels. I was in one small nation recently with a large number of far-flung communities where it's very difficult for government auditors to gain access due to the geography and the logistical constraints on them. And as a result, in too many instances, resources were going into projects that were never coming to realization. Because the money instead would be diverted into somebody's pocket, and there was no way to ensure accountability on the ground. But we've seen a very exciting civil society effort to train volunteer monitors who are notified when the government funds a project in their community, and then they provide regular reports on the progress of that project to ensure that the money is actually going where it's supposed to go. And they provide those reports using text messages and very basic technology tools that enable instantaneous communication. Another very exciting example comes from a larger country where a group of 1,000 accountants got together and volunteered their time to crowdsource a review of the federal budget. And in this case, by divvying up a very large budget among a large group of people, they were able to go through and find tens of millions of dollars that were being diverted to improper uses, and then raise the attention of the media that applied pressure on elected leaders to correct these challenges. So we're seeing already crowdsourcing platforms and technology play a crucial role in opening up governance and ensuring greater accountability. And I think we're just at the very beginning of this revolution. So it's going to be an incredibly exciting time to be working on these issues. And I think the biggest innovations in this space are still to come.
One of the recurrent themes we hear from students in this class and from other people I interact with around the world, particularly in authoritarian countries and others where space for independent use of the internet is constricted and often shrinking, is an appeal, in essence, for help. How can you help us? How can the international community help us get wider, more unfettered access to the internet? And so we have a question here. The person wished to remain anonymous, probably because they're living in one of those countries. Is there any international partnership that could help people in authoritarian societies build a civil society in part by overcoming internet censorship?
There are a number of excellent international partnerships that are seeking to take on this challenge. And this work has taken a variety of different forms. Many of the world's leading technology companies have come together in corporate roundtables to ensure that their conduct does not compromise internet freedom, which is an area, frankly, where we've seen some big problems in the past. We've also seen a number of governments come together at the Human Rights Council in Geneva and through bodies like the Community of Democracies, which recently established a working group on the freedom of expression to try and address this challenge. Ultimately, this is a problem that's going to require a lot of different partners coming to the table to work together. We know that the technologies that we're talking about don't take sides in this struggle. They can be used for good or they can be used for ill. And just like steel can help construct a hospital, or it can be used to make machetes, or nuclear power can light up a city or be used to destroy it, the internet doesn't take sides in this effort. But we do, and I think it's important for those who share a commitment to openness, who want to see one internet single, whole, and free work together through international bodies and also independently. And in this space, I would highlight that the United States has committed now tens and tens of millions of dollars to support internet freedom and to develop new technologies that advance the cause of internet freedom. It's something that we care about a great deal, and we will continue that work.
So one of the things that's happening is that there's a big investment that has been made and is being made in circumvention technologies like Tor that would enable people to tunnel under the censorship or find other ways of circumventing it. A question that was directed to me from another anonymous viewer, I'm guessing it might have come from China, asks about the growth of internet technologies in developing authoritarian regimes like China, and will it help to build a civil society, or simply will this technology more empower the authoritarian regime? Because certainly in China, authoritarian rule is watching what people are doing. We know there are cameras all over the place. Beijing is as a city where it's hard to move around without being photographed. And I'd just like to reply in this way. There are certainly tens of thousands of internet police in China. We know this. By some accounts, many tens of thousands. There are certainly quite a number of people, by one estimate, 50,000 people, young people primarily, I believe, who are being paid to post comments on various blog sites to make favorable comments about the government. We know that when explicitly critical material is posted on the internet in China, it's pounced on relatively quickly and removed because it represents harmful content. We know all of this. But we also know that with the explosion of the internet and microblogging now, where you have literally several hundred million Chinese citizens who are microbloggers, it's just impossible for the state to effectively control or insulate all of this. And one of the things that's so wonderful and so clever and a representation of democratic innovation is the way in which citizens are innovating in the use of language in order to get around the state censors. So if you can't use the words June 4th anymore to refer to the crackdown in 1989 in Tiananmen Square, just call it May 35th. And then eventually the censors will get onto that and you shift again. But I think what's happening in China, this is my answer to the question that was posed from our student, and then I'd like you to comment. And it raises the broader questions we've been dealing with about democratic development and what drives it, is that China is facing a dilemma now, which I think, unfortunately, the leadership is not really effectively wrestling with. And that is that as a country grows and modernizes, society changes. It becomes more complex. A middle class emerges, as it is now emerging in China. Values change. People want more autonomy, more freedom of self-expression, more ability to take initiative. And if the political system doesn't at least adapt, this doesn't mean instant democratization, but breathe, open up to allow more expression, more space, more civic pluralism, more ability of citizens to have voice, criticize their government, express their interests, and eventually some role in holding their leaders accountable and maybe at least at lower levels initially replacing their leaders, you've got a difficult situation. You've got a problem, and that is the problem I've posed in the recent article called The 70-Year Itch about what's confronting China now. So that is my response to the student. I don't think the regime is ultimately going to be very successful in dealing with this. But how do you view that general problem, or more specifically, the situation in China?
I would say that any successful modern society, by definition, is too complex for any one entity, any one person, any one party to govern all alone. And in order to achieve goals like accountability, the eradication of corruption that we've heard are very important to leaders in China and other countries, you need the participation of citizens. You need civil society to help in that work. It simply can't be done by government operating on its own. And so my hope would be, again, that there will be greater space for civil society in China to address these issues. We've seen some troubling trends recently, and even in the last few months, there's been a crackdown that has resulted in the incarceration of a number of individuals who had been working on behalf of greater openness and accountability. Hopefully, that will pass, and there'll be a realization that in China or any other nation that is seeking to realize its potential, you need partnership with civil society in order to accomplish that goal.
So, Tomicah, our hour is just about up. I'd like to close with this question, if I may, which is my question. It's not one that was sent in. And maybe it goes a little bit beyond the scope of our conversation this morning. till now, but I think it's important to ask in closing. Many of the students in this class, or at least some number of them, when they hear a series of lectures from an American professor about building democracy, criticizing authoritarian rule in other countries, thinking about different models of democracy. We certainly do not in this class push the American model, which is a cumbersome one to operate, has a lot of veto points, and I don't believe that the presidential system in general is probably the best way of organizing democracy. But in any case, it's possible to detect a tone of, oh, you think you're the best democracy in the world and, you know, everybody should just follow you. Now, I'm trying very hard to not project that tone. And indeed, the final lecture of this class on American democracy, kind of looking at it critically with warts and all, I'm making available to the class now so they can kind of see this in context. But when people say, well, who are you to talk about democracy? You know, Guantanamo, NSA, you know, incarceration of quite a significant percentage of African-American youth in prison, vastly disproportionately to their numbers in society. You got a lot of problems with American democracy. Why don't you worry about your own democracy and let the rest of the world worry about theirs? How do you reply?
Well, I have two responses. The first is that democracy is a road traveled and not a destination, and we're all on that path together. And so I think we need to recognize that we all benefit when we can work with each other along the way to make the journey a little bit easier. The second thing I would say is part of the reason that we do attempt to support democracy around the world is because we recognize that we don't have all the answers. And we know that there are great ideas and great innovations in other countries that we will benefit from as we see them applied here at home. Let me again provide an analogy from the technology sector, if I can, for a moment. When you see a venture capital firm investing in a new startup in another country, it's not because they think that we have all the answers in the United States and we know everything about how to master it in technology. It's precisely because we want to see the growth of new ideas. We want to see the germination of solutions that can help people around the world and that can be spread and scaled to support citizens in many different nations. And I think democracy support, frankly, is very much the same. This is not a franchise operation for us. We're not trying to build a lot of different countries that all look like the United States and all act like the United States. Rather, this is an opportunity for democracies everywhere to innovate, for us to develop the startups within our own nations that are going to allow citizens and governments to interact more successfully, that are going to ensure higher degrees of accountability, and that are going to help our citizens to realize their full potential. And that's ultimately the goal that we're trying to pursue. Again, this is something that is much bigger than the United States. This is something that's much bigger than any one democracy. This goes to the very core of who we are as human beings. And I think we all have the opportunity, and in many ways the responsibility, to try and create a civic ecosystem that will allow us to accomplish that goal.
Well, Tomicah Tillemann, thank you for having us here
in
the State Department.
And all your MOOC students as well, who are, I think, real pioneers in this work and are doing extraordinary things, as are you, through this course.
Thank you. I can tell you from interacting with many of them are very much or aspire to be on the front lines of working on the challenges you have talked about deepening civil society and building a viable, accountable, responsive, and high-quality democracy in their countries. And thank you also for the work you're doing to help develop the community of democracies, the Open Government Partnership, and other efforts of democracies working together as peers to build a collection of more effective, accountable democracies in the world. So,
well, Larry, a great pleasure talking with you and especially all of your students.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.